Hey programmers, welcome back to the second part of my timecode tutorial. Last week, we started from scratch and we used the internal generator to record a couple of cues. Today, I want to dig further into the options that you have and look at different ways that we can edit our timecode shows. Even if you think you're going to be doing all of your time coding with a third-party piece of software that uses markers to generate events, you're still going to need to know how to edit what gets produced. Otherwise, you're really just scratching the surface of what timecode can do. There are two settings options within our timecode window. One is the timecode window settings, which is for the window itself, so not to be confused with the other settings option, which is for the timecode show you're currently working with. In the timecode window settings, we already use the first option to select which show we're working with. In the second column, the tool option will toggle us through the different tool options from the left side of the window. Obviously, we can click on any tool we need at any point to activate it. We already saw the option to turn the playback bar on or off. Appearance and target are options that we turn on or off depending on whether we want to see them on our tracks. I think target is pretty important, and setting different appearances for tracks might be useful for organization. The next column is specifically to set how much or how little you want to see within the timeline. If there are a lot of events on your track, you might choose to turn something off here. In this column, some of these options, like the mode, view mode, and text mode, are the same as the options at the top of the window. Cursor mode determines how your playhead at the top of the timeline will look as you're receiving timecode. With center, the cursor will play until it reaches center, and then the timeline will move. With page, the whole timeline will move or jump over along with the cursor. And both of these options will need this little stopwatch icon to be toggled on. The settings button at the top of the window is for our selected timecode show. We used the timecode slot option in the last video to switch from the internal option to slot 1. Just like MA2, offset allows us to offset our timecode playback by an amount of time, and duration specifies how long our timecode track is. We can place our cursor at a specific moment in time by using this option here. Under playback are more familiar options like starting and stopping timecoded triggers when timecode comes into the desk. The looping options determine how playback will be handled when reaching the end of the duration of an internally generated timecode. We could keep replaying the timecode with a loop option, or stop at the end using off, or very similar to off, we can choose pause and the timecode will stop, but it will leave our controls on the pause mode. And of course, do we want to have the timecode triggered cues kept in playback when we switch off timecode, or do we want them to be turned off as well? If assert previous events is set to yes, and say you start the timecode playback in the middle of a song, the console will immediately put your playback in the state it's meant to be at that point of the song. If it's set to no, and you start timecode playback in the middle of the song, the console will not play back any cues until we reach a point in the song that has a trigger. This looks to me to be the status call option from MA2, just with a new name. The display readouts are all about how you want your timing to be displayed and the frames per second. This last option is kind of nice. It's a choice for when you're recording timecoded cue playback. Do you want your command to be a go plus or a go to? And no matter which you pick, you can always edit them afterwards if you need to make a change. If there are options here that you'd like to be the defaults for your timecoded shows going forward, then go to Menu, then Preferences and Timing, and Timecode. Then make your changes here. The timecode tool buttons on the left are best understood using the timeline view. I want to make these events a little easier to see. I can use the zoom in and out options up at the top to do this. You might also use the magnifier to reset to see all of the events. Most of the buttons on the left are tied to your select target, so let's start with events. The arrow is our basic selection tool. Say I wanted to copy this temp button trigger here. I can select it, then click on this copy tool, then move my playhead wherever I want the copy to go and click this paste button. There's also a cut option that you can use with paste. If I just want to manually move a trigger, I can use the Move button, select an event, and slide it wherever I want it to go. We also saw last time that we can use the minus tool to delete an event. There's also a lot of editing that could be done on your encoder wheels when you're in setup mode. You can move your playhead cursor, change which track is selected, select an event, and move it on the timeline with the time option. At the bottom are options for selecting and working with markers and time ranges, which I'm going to get to, but first let's finish up with the tool buttons. This option with a plus and play sign is to add an event at the location of my playhead. And of course, I can edit this event to make it whatever I want it to be. You want to watch which track is selected when you're working like this so that events go where you want them to. You can also use this button to add multiple events at a particular place in the timeline. The pop-up allows us to say how many events and set a time interval between each. The resize tool is for markers and time ranges, and the last two options are to add markers. Both options allow you to add a marker at the playhead, but the first option prompts you to add a label, while the second one just adds a marker. You can always label it later. In the text side, you can select markers from the text mode dropdown to make it quick and easy to edit them. If you've ever used timeline-based audio or video editing software, you already have a general idea of what markers could be used for. I'm going to show you how to work with them, but first we need to understand editing in the text view. I'm currently set to events as my select target, and then I want all as my text mode. For any event, I can turn on a lock if I want to prevent editing, but with a lock off, I could do some editing like changing the time when my event is triggered, or change a fader value. Under token, I can change what the command is, and if I need to change which queue is triggered, I can pick a different one from the queue destination column. Status is for stuff like temps and flashes. I did record a temp button earlier, and let's notice that the default token was set to on, not temp. If I change the token to temp, then I can change the status to on or off. This execute command option determines whether or not any additional commands that you've placed on the triggered queue within the sequence will be executed or not. Now let's get into markers and time ranges. These aren't at all requirements to make your timecode shows work, but they might help you organize. If I change my select target to time ranges, we can see how we can use the same sort of tools to work with ranges and markers. These are ways we can annotate our timelines and also do some editing. Here's an example of a timecode show with multiple ranges and markers. You might use them to notate when something's happening on stage or in the music, maybe even setting up ranges or markers for verses or choruses. If your entire show is one long single continuous track of timecode, you might end up using these to mark where different songs or acts or architectural changes happen. There are some differences between markers and time ranges. First off, a time range is specific to a track, whereas a marker is shown over the entire track group. While both can be used to help us locate certain sections of our timeline easier, a time range has an added function. It can actually move all of the events within it to a different section of the timeline. We haven't talked much about track groups. Like a lot of options on the console, these groups are here to help you organize. You can add as many as you like, or you can just keep all of your tracks in just one group. If you do add new track groups, when you're ready to start recording to one, make it the selected track group. Okay, let's get back to our original timecode show and make some markers and ranges to better see how this stuff works. Remember that we can use these options in the left side toolbar to add in a marker to our timeline. And the first option automatically prompts me to label it. Or you can use a second option and then just label it later in the text view. We can add as many as we need to mark any moments in the song for easy retrieval. Once I've got my markers in, I can use the encoder wheel to cycle through them, and that will move my playhead cursor, so it's an easy way to jump to a section of my track. Or I can use these nice new marker shortcuts in the playback bar to skip between markers. And markers don't have to be single frames. They can have a duration as well. I can make this a longer duration here on my wheels or in the duration column of my text view. You can also use the resize tool to drag it over the timeline. Not surprisingly, stuff like move works as well. And we can use appearances to change the color and make it really obvious. Now onto time ranges. We've already got a couple of time ranges in our show that were created based on our recording, and you can see that they're separated by track. If you want to add a new time range in, then set your select target to time ranges, hit the plus button, and click on the timeline wherever you'd like it to start. Or you can draw over a range of time. You can always tweak the actual timestamps in the text window or on your wheels, or resize it with the resize tool on screen. You can move them too, but be careful with this. Unlike moving markers, a time range has the ability to move any events associated with it. Check this out. If I select one of the time ranges that's associated with my song sequence and I move it, it moves all of the events, all of my triggers in that range. This could be handy if you need to offset a section of your time-coded events. Are you going to be using timecode for all of your shows? Possibly not. And let's face it, it is a lot more fun to play back the cues ourselves to the music rather than letting timecode run the show. But for a lot of large tours, timecoding to SMPTE is a big part of our gig as programmers. In case you can't tell from these videos, I absolutely love timecode. I really do enjoy playing with it and trying new things and learning new workflows. There's definitely some things I like to see updated or get implemented, but hey, that's just how I feel about a lot of things on a new console. I hope you'll try playing with timecode and maybe love it as much as I do. Thanks for watching.